Belinda, and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of The Mighty Krait, written by Ian McPhedran and read by Peter Byrne. In memory of Douglas Herps and Warwick Thompson. Glossary. Two IC, second in command. ADF, Australian Defence Force. AIB, Allied Intelligence Bureau. ANMM, Australian National Maritime Museum. AWM, Australian War Memorial. Bulwark, an extension of a boat's sides above deck level. DSC, Distinguished Service Cross. DSO, Distinguished Service Order. Tholboat, folding, timber-framed, canvas-covered, two-man canoe. Forecastle, the forward deck of a ship. Framing, the structure that gives a vessel its shape. Garboard, the first planks or plates laid next to a vessel's keel. Head, a marine toilet. HMAS, Her or His Majesty's Australian Ship. HMB, His or Her Majesty's Bark. HMS, Her or His Majesty's Ship. Hold, a storage area for cargo on a ship. ISD, Inter-Allied Services Department. Keel, the main structure along the length of the bottom of a boat. MC, Military Cross. MI5, Great Britain's Domestic Intelligence Service. MI6, Great Britain's Overseas Intelligence Service. MID, mentioned in dispatches. MM, Military Medal. MV, Motor Vessel. PTS, Post-Traumatic Stress. PTSD, Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder. RAAF, Royal Australian Air Force. RAN, Royal Australian Navy. RANVR, Royal Australian Navy Volunteer Reserve. RNR, Royal Navy Reserve. RVCP, Royal Volunteer Coastal Patrol. SAS, Special Air Service Regiment. Sea State, the degree of turbulence at sea according to average wave height. Seine, a fishing net that floats vertically in the water to encircle fish. SOA, Special Operations Australia. SOE, Special Operations Executive. SP, Starting Price. SRD, Services Reconnaissance Department. SS, Steamship. UN, United Nations. USN, United States Navy. USS, United States Ship. VC, Victoria Cross, the highest Imperial Australian Award for Valour. ZES, Z Experimental Station. Preface. It was a warm summer's day in 1969 when I first heard the remarkable story of a small wooden Japanese-built fishing vessel called the Krait, and her role in one of the most audacious commando missions undertaken during World War II. The late Australian war correspondent and author Ronald McKee, a friend of my father, Colin, gave me the job of mowing his large lawn on the side of Mount Gibraltar in my hometown of Barrel in the New South Wales Southern Highlands. When the mowing was done, he would treat me to a glass of lemonade in the cool of his study, whose walls were adorned with a collection of framed front pages showing his reports from the Asian and European theatres of World War II. McKee would also regale me with his adventures as a war correspondent, which, to the eager ears of a 12-year-old boy, were simply enthralling. They remain enthralling to this day. One of the most extraordinary tales, which he had turned into a best-selling book, The Heroes, published in 1960, was the story of Operation Jaywick. This was the code name for a successful attack against Japanese shipping in Singapore Harbour on the night of the 26th of September, 1943. A second, but disastrous mission, a year later, was codenamed Operation Rimau. The Jaywick raid is the stuff of legend among special forces. But outside those specialized circles, it is well known only to Australians of the surviving wartime and immediate post-war generations and military aficionados. Still less familiar is the story of the small, nondescript timber fishing boat that carried the 14 Allied commandos into the heart of enemy territory and delivered them safely back home. That story continues to this day as the boat undergoes a new, careful renovation at the hands of expert shipwrights to bring her back to her 1943 configuration and to claim her rightful position as the symbolic flagship of Australian Special Forces operations. September 2018 marks the 75th anniversary of the Krait's amazing journey, but there is much more to the story of The Little Boat That Could. Ian McPhedran, Sydney, 2018. Prologue. Late on the night of the 26th of September, 1943, six young men with blackened faces, paddling three canvas-covered, two-man folding canoes, slid silently into Singapore Harbour at the sharp end of one of the most daring and successful Special Forces raids in the history of warfare. As the lights of the occupied city blazed defiantly, none of the thousands of Japanese troops in the garrison, nor the hundreds of sailors on board the dozens of ships anchored in the harbour, could have imagined the cunning act of sabotage that was about to unfold. Singapore in late 1943 was the impregnable heart of the rapidly expanding Japanese Empire, and a prison island for thousands of Australians and other Allied troops at the infamous Changi prisoner of war camp. Just like the British imperialists before him, the then Prime Minister of Japan, General Hideki Tojo, regarded the Japanese-occupied island as untouchable. After attaching magnetic limpet mines to seven ships, the six raiders sneaked out of the harbour at the start of an arduous and exhausting 80-kilometre island-hopping return paddle, hoping and praying that they would be able to rendezvous with their mother ship, the MV Krait, for the long voyage home to Australia. Reaching their first lying-up position on a tiny island off Singapore several hours later, four of the saboteurs climbed a hill from where they could see the brilliant lights. They watched and listened in awe as seven Japanese vessels either went to the bottom of the harbour or sustained serious damage from the mines they had attached below the waterline. Mostyn Moss Berryman was a reserve canoeist who, instead of going on the raid, remained on board the Krait with seven shipmates while the vessel prowled around the islands and inlets of southern Borneo, hiding in plain sight, disguised as a Japanese fishing boat, and waiting to pick up the returning operatives. Aged 95, and in 2018, the last survivor of Operation Jaywick, Berryman remembered the first time he laid eyes on the Krait as if it were yesterday. The young Navy volunteer and his mates had spent several weeks in training at the secret commando bush camp known as Camp X at Refuge Bay on the lower Hawkesbury River north of Sydney, when, early one morning, a strange vessel motored into the bay. Berryman was taken aback by the sight of the ugly, squat, 21-metre timber boat. The keen 18-year-old sailor had expected to be posted to a nice big warship. 75 years later, at home in a retirement village in Adelaide, the clear-eyed, smartly dressed old gentleman recalled his commanding officer, Captain Ivan Lyon, ordering the team to paddle out and take a good look at the boat that would be their home for the next few months. It looked Japanese. It was named Japanese. And it smelled Japanese. It was a bit fishy, Berryman said. We climbed aboard, and there was nothing there. She was as bare as a baby's behind. No fridge, no bunks, no toilet, no nothing. The men continued training hard and soon became experts at assembling special canvas-covered two-man folding canoes, or foalboats, in double-quick time and paddling them over long distances in a variety of sea states. Around the campfire at night, they would speculate about what their top-secret mission could be and where this rickety-looking boat could possibly carry them. After some argy-bargy, the consensus was that the enemy-held port city of Rabaul on the island of New Britain in New Guinea was the most likely target. We'd read that there was a big harbour there, and there was going to be something to be blown up in Rabaul, Berryman recalled. Not one of the young operatives imagined that the real target for their strange boat and her highly trained crew would be the enemy fortress of Singapore. As it turned out, we broke the world record, Berryman said with justifiable pride. Nobody in the history of the world had ever gone that far into enemy territory and come out alive. A Very Special Bunch. One. A Twist of Fate. Millions of visitors to the Australian National Maritime Museum in Sydney's Darling Harbour have strolled past the array of historic vessels on display in the water, but few might have noticed, let alone paid much attention to, a black, low-slung, wooden, ex-fishing vessel that was moored behind a locked gate for years. Far more impressive to the casual eye are the old Oberon-class submarine, HMAS Onslow, the destroyer HMAS Vampire, and the beautiful replica of Captain Cook's ship, HMB Endeavour, that grace the waters outside the museum. Yet, it was this very ability to avoid attention that enabled the modest former Japanese fishing boat, the MV Krait, to travel further behind enemy lines than any other vessel in history, and then sink more enemy shipping than any Australian warship during World War II. Only a global conflict could throw up such a bizarre twist of fate that would see a boat built in Japan in 1934, 7 years before that country even entered the war, morph into one of Australia's most important monuments to human imagination and courage. Over the years, many tourists strolling by on Remembrance Day, the 11th of November, gave no more than a passing glance, if that, to an old man as he bent down at exactly 11 a.m. to lay a flower in the water next to the little boat. This was a pilgrimage that the late World War II Z Special Unit veteran Douglas Herps made for years from his home in the genteel suburb of Woollahra. It was his way of honouring not only the 14 men who served in MV Krait, but all those from the top secret special operations units, including his own Z Special Unit, who paid the ultimate sacrifice during clandestine missions throughout Southeast Asia and New Guinea during World War II. Some were his mates, many others he'd never met and would never meet. Such was the secretive, cell-like operating structure of the units that were the predecessors of the modern-day Special Air Service and Commando regiments. Z Special Unit was established to administer the army and civilian members who operated under the umbrella of Special Operations Australia. Like many former wartime Special Forces operatives Herps took his legal responsibilities for keeping official secrets very seriously. And even 70 years after the war had ended, he was reluctant to discuss his own role in any detail. He would take those secrets to the grave, as he had solemnly sworn to do. However, he was happy to talk at great length and with passion about the sacrifice of the many operatives who did not come home. One of his earlier projects had been to document and photograph the graves of fallen Z-men.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.